In that closing sentence she invites them to go on crusade with her to rescue the Holy Sepulchre. No answer had been returned to this proclamation, and the messenger himself had not come back. So now she sent her two heralds with a new letter warning the English to raise the siege and requiring them to restore that missing messenger. The heralds came back without him. All they brought was notice from the English to Joan that they would presently catch her and burn her if she did not clear out now while she had a chance, and go back to her proper trade of minding cows. She held her peace, only saying it was a pity that the English could persist in inviting present disaster and eventual destruction when she was doing all she could to get them out of the country with their lives still in their bodies. Presently she thought of an arrangement that might be acceptable, and said to the heralds, "Go back, and say to Lord Talbot this from me. Come out of your Bastille with your host, and I will come with mine. If I beat you, go in peace out of France. If you beat me, burn me, according to your desire." I did not hear this, but Dunois did, and spoke of it. The challenge was refused. Sunday morning her voices, or some instinct, gave her a warning, and she sent Dunois to Blois to take command of the army and hurry it to Orléans. It was a wise move, for he found Regnault de Chartres and some more of the king's pet rascals there trying their best to disperse the army, and crippling all the efforts of Joan's generals to head it for Orléans. They were a fine lot, those miscreants. They turned their attention to Dunois now, but he had balked Joan once, with unpleasant results to himself, and was not minded to meddle in that way again. He soon had the army moving. End of chapter 14. Personal Recollections of Joan of Arc by Mark Twain. Volume 1, Book 2, Chapter 15. My Exquisite Poem Goes to Smash. We of the personal staff were in fairyland now during the few days that we waited for the return of the army. We went into society. To our two knights this was not a novelty, but to us young villagers it was a new and wonderful life. Any position of any sort near the person of the maid of Vaucouleurs conferred high distinction upon the holder, and caused his society to be courted. And so the Dark brothers, and Noel, and the Paladin, humble peasants at home, were gentlemen here, personages of weight and influence. It was fine to see how soon their country diffidences and awkwardnesses melted away under this pleasant sun of deference, and disappeared, and how lightly and easily they took to their new atmosphere. The Paladin was as happy as it was possible for any one in this earth to be. His tongue went all the time, and daily he got new delight out of hearing himself talk. He began to enlarge his ancestry and spread it out all around, and ennoble it right and left, and it was not long until it consisted almost entirely of dukes. He worked up his old battles and tricked them out with fresh splendors, also with new terrors, for he added artillery now. We had seen cannon for the first time at Blois, a few pieces. Here there was plenty of it, and now and then we had the impressive spectacle of a huge English Bastille hidden from sight in a mountain of smoke from its own guns, with lances of red flame darting through it, and this grand picture, along with the quaking thunders pounding away in the heart of it, inflamed the Paladin's imagination and enabled him to dress out those ambuscade skirmishes of ours with a sublimity which made it impossible for any to recognize them at all, except people who had not been there. You may suspect that there was a special inspiration for these great efforts of the Paladins, and there was. It was the daughter of the house, Catherine Boucher, who was 18, and gentle and lovely in her ways, and very beautiful. I think she might have been as beautiful as Joan herself, if she had had Joan's eyes, but that could never be. There was never but that one pair. There will never be another. Joan's eyes were deep and rich and wonderful beyond anything merely earthly. They spoke all the languages. They had no need of words. They produced all effects, and just by a glance, just a single glance, a glance that could convict a liar of his lie and make him confess it, that could bring down a proud man's pride and make him humble, that could put courage into a coward and strike dead the courage of the bravest, that could appease resentments and real hatreds, that could make the doubter believe and the hopeless hope again, that could purify the impure mind, that could persuade. Ah, there it is, persuasion. That is the word. What or who is it that it couldn't persuade? The maniac of Domremy, the fairy banishing priest, the reverend tribunal of Toul, the doubting and superstitious Laxart, the obstinate veteran of Vaucouleurs, the characterless heir of France, the sages and scholars of the Parliament and University of Poitiers, the darling of Satan, La Hire, the masterless bastard of Orleans, accustomed to acknowledge no way as right and rational but his own. These were the trophies of that great gift that made her the wonder and mystery that she was.